Hello. You're here, aren't you? Welcome to the leak. I was just getting started on something I've been planning to do for a while now, replacement power supply for the Commodore 64. I haven't been in a great hurry to do this, but after watching Mindfly Retro's last video about power supplies and the BWACC C64 saver, I got a bit inspired and I thought I'd get started on it. But before we get started building, I'd like to talk about something that, in some countries, could be a risk to our retro computers, and a risk that is not completely addressed by using an overvoltage protection in line on the cable. And it has to do with politics, and specifically what voltage is actually coming out of the wall socket in your home. Mains electricity, or utility power, or hydro, if you prefer, is usually referred to in its respective country as the number of the voltage. So in continental Europe and Scandinavia, we usually call it the 220. But looking into the socket, this is not actually true, because this is what I'm getting. And according to international standard IEC 60038, we can see that before 1987, 220 was the neutral phase voltage with the tolerance level of plus minus 10%. And this is what most devices from this era are designed for. So that's all fine, I guess, because 232 volts, that's within the 10%. So that shouldn't be an issue for the power supply of this era. But if we look at what I actually have in the socket over a day, it's constantly pushing 230, almost above, even above 235. So it's not just temporarily high voltages, is constantly high voltages pushing into the upper end of the tolerance range. And the Commodore 64 power supply that is already struggling with questionable design in terms of heat dissipation has even more energy it needs to dissipate. So what happened? Well, already in the 18th century, Voltaire was fighting against unnecessary tension in the world, and that's completely irrelevant, but I couldn't help myself. So, seriously, in the early 90s, we wanted to harmonize the voltage levels around the world. And for example, in Europe, we had a problem with the UK running 240 volts, even 250 in some parts, and the continental Europe and Scandinavia usually having 220 volts. And this was generally considered a problem. So the EU decided to set 230 volts as their standard voltage. And this was in the beginning mostly a paper product because they also adjusted the tolerance levels to work with what we had in the respective countries. But by the end of the 90s, many countries in Europe had moved to the recommended value of 230 with a tolerance between 6 and 10%. And throughout the 90s, new products coming to market was already designed for 230 as the center voltage, with the possible exception for light bulbs because physics is a bitch. It's very difficult to design a traditional light bulb for this tolerance range. Also, traditional transformer-based power supplies could have an issue with this range, but it's mostly a matter of aiming for a voltage and make sure you have enough heat dissipation for any voltage you need to handle. So this poor old retro computer, almost 40 years old, expected to have the energy output of a 3-year-old, with the added stress of political decisions that just didn't matter to it when it was young. Yeah, I can relate to this. So let's get on with the build. And I found this power socket that I'm planning to put in a plastic box. It has an integrated fuse and switch, and it will be connected internally in the box to a 9-volt AC transformer. And I'm planning to put actually a Euro power socket inside the box and use a standard USB charger to source the 5 volts reliably. And the Commodore 64 uses 5 volts as a power source for its digital components, but it also has a 9-volt AC line for various things. It uses it as a reference for the time of day clock, and it also creates another set of 5 volts and 12 volts for the analog circuits in the Commodore, for example, the SID chip and the VIC. Of course, in the new short boards, the 12 volts doesn't exist, but there's still the AC is needed for the time of day clock, among other things, and also to source the 9 volt voltage for the new SID and VIC. And here I've drawn up the square or the rectangle I need to cut out for the power plug. And I'll Dremel that out from the plastic, and hopefully I won't destroy anything. So when using an overvoltage protection for the Commodore 64, you're usually only working with a 5 volt, because it's the 5 volt line that fails in the power supply, and that one that shoots overvoltage and kills the digital logic in your Commodore. The 9 volt line usually doesn't fail in this way. So here we have the transformer in the box, and I will drill out some holes to attach it safely to the side. Got the plug in nicely, and I'll warm down these screws so that they are flush with the plastic. That should be safely mounted. Looks good. Paint them in black. Okay, that'll do for now. So here we are. The plug wired in with the switches and the fuses. And the transformer, I also managed to put a fuse holder for the secondary side, for the 9 volt side that I found from a surplus. So this should be a great start. Now it's time to work on the 5 volt line. So about the 9 volt line, if you're running a 220 volt power supply off 235 volts from the wall socket, you're constantly feeding an overvoltage into the 9 volt AC line as well. And the regulators inside the Commodore 64 has to dissipate this as extra heat. And this will cause extra stress on the internal regulators inside the Commodore 64 as well. So an overvoltage protection is great for the 5 volt line from the power supply because of its horrible, horrible design. But the 9 volt line is also affected by the old power supply and will cause a constant long-term stress to the regulators. And of course, I forgot the strain relief. I shouldn't work and talk at the same time, which I'm not. But, you know, just pretend. It makes me look less stupid. All right, let's focus on the build. Most of it's done, actually. I got the transformer and the plug and everything in here, and I'm going to strip down a USB cable. This one has been bothering me for a while with the micro USB doesn't stay connected properly. So I'll cut it down and put DC cables on it and fill it with hot glue, shrink wrap, and some hot air. And that looks quite good, actually. For a power cable, I'll use a pair of speaker cables. I didn't have any four conductor cables, and I'll wrap them in this spiral wrap that is supposed to keep them together. And the spiral together with the shrink wrap here will double as a strain relief when I'm putting it in the box. Okay, cable is all done. Obviously homemade, but still, I think it's looking quite good. So the USB charger, 2.4 amps should be enough for our needs. A 6 millimeter hole for the cable is intentionally a bit narrow, but that'll be a good strain relief. So now it's all soldering the cable and the connector for USB, and soldering in the transformer on the 9 volt pair of wires. And that's a done deal. Excellent. Checking the voltages, 10.7 unloaded. Okay, yeah, that's quite good. On the 5 volt, should be almost exactly 5, yeah. So this is all in line with our expectations. And plugging in my excellent Ribocop overvoltage protection, it has a very nice indication diodes there that can help me see everything looks okay. And yeah, it does. Now, the best way to see how it performs is probably to bring in a rocket scientist for rigorous testing with an actual Commodore 64. I think it's been improved. Voltages look good, 4.8 on the 5-volt line. A little bit low, it's not a problem, and actually it's quite comforting. And the AC line has 9.8 volts loaded, and seeing a 9 there at all is very, very comforting, because usually you don't if you run on a 220 supply. 9 millivolt ripple on the 5-volt. It's not a problem. It's gonna do quite well, this one. So the question is, am I satisfied with the result? Yeah, I think I am. It looks tidy and it works well. Was it logom effort? Probably not. Bit more work than I had planned, but it turned out well, so that's fine. And the third question, for roughly 30-35 euros in parts, was it worth the money? Not really.